Hello everyone, this is Bob and Threadbare, and welcome back to L.A. Noire. We've got a unique opener here. We are in fact far from the police station.
You like the fight game, Phelps? I did a little boxing in the Marines. I found it a pretty humbling experience.
Fix you a sandwich, buddy. Corned beef and egg salad, 12 cents. Bologna and ham and cheese, 10.
It's strictly a mug's game. You'll like this fight, though. A plucky limey's about to take a beating from an up-and-coming Negro.
You sound pretty sure about the result.
I ought to be. I got 50 bucks on the black kid. Let's get a ringside seat.
So I will say this. The bodies of the boxers do some very nice textures. But they don't really match up with the heads very well. Look a bit like Rock'em Sock'em Robots.
Son of a bitch Hammond made a run for his dressing room. Let's find out what's going on. God damn you, Albert! You get out here right now!
Step back! LAPD!
Alright, gonna have to change the jacket there again. Technical difficulties. Happens every once in a while. I have to restart the mission and, when I do so, his jacket also resets.
What's going on?
That son of a bitch Hammond has jammed the door.
And who are you?
Carlo Arcaro. I'm his manager.
I'm his trainer.
Interesting attitude to have towards a victorious athlete.
Victorious? We had an arrangement. We had a goddamn arrangement!
That limey bastard was paid to take a nap. He reneged.
And you were out of pocket?
Damn right. Me and a couple hundred other people.
Stand aside.
He squeezed out the window. I'll put an APB out on him.
Why would we do that? He won the fight fair and square.
To prevent him from getting clipped. He was paid to flop. There was big money riding on this.
So are we here because you lost money or because we're investigating a prize fighting racket?
Very funny. Look around and see what you can find. Which is Hammond's locker?
Over by the pinboard, second from the end.
Silly Cole, you still think this isn't a crooked city? Huh, another newspaper. Oh, we're in September now.
You look troubled.
I'm in a jam, Doctor.
Can I help, Courtney? Is it money?
No, Doctor. That's okay. Do I have your professional confidence?
Whatever you say, we'll never leave this room.
I talked some of the guys in my old unit into doing something, and it's gone wrong. I guess I did it for the wrong reasons, for short-term gain. We came home from China on the Cool Ridge.
The morphine robbery.
That was us. I thought I could get the guys a fair share. Some sort of benefit for the sacrifices that they made in the war. Those guys deserve it, Doctor.
Oh, I'm sure they do, Courtney. But the deserving aren't always rewarded.
Tell me about it, Doc. We shifted our stuff onto this mob-connected guy, and it's been turning up all over town. It wasn't meant to be like this.
The presumption was rather naive, Courtney.
I know that now, Doctor. But people are dying. Hmm.
Might I venture a few questions?
Sure.
Do your underworld contacts have all the morphine?
No, they don't. We doled it out, hoping we could control it.
Are they pressing you for further allocation?
That's the polite way of putting it, Doctor.
I may be able to help you, Courtney.
Thanks, Doc. It helps just to talk about it.
I mean, I have a solution that will help you financially and salve your conscience.
I'm all ears, Doctor.
I will transact to take all the narcotic off your hands. Rest assured that it will all be medically administered. I will use the funds that I no longer require for the purchase of medication and invest them in housing developments.
Housing?
The developments in question are housing projects for former servicemen. Your return will come from the sale of the properties, and your investment will benefit those that you care for most. Does this arrangement meet with your approval?
You're a magician, Doctor.
Alakazam. You know, I think this one actually might be a meanwhile. That or it did happen a little earlier. Notices up on this board. Also, okay. Don't care about a boxing glove. I want you to look at that lineup there on the left. Because some of the names on that are going to come up later.
There's a phone number we can run by R&I, plus a bunch of names and odds. You're not the only one who likes a flutter, Roy.
Man, the British guy was not going to win this one, according to the odds. Roughly 20 to 1, according to all bookies, Hammond was going to lose.
You better find that cocksucker and you bring him to me.
I feel bad too, Mickey. He guaranteed me he would take the flop.
I guarantee that you will be fish food if you don't bring me... Roy? You out of pocket, too?
Mickey? Seems that way.
Don't worry about it. My boys are out looking for him.
Well, you'd better call them off. This is a police matter now. If anything happens to Hammond, I'll testify that you made threats against him.
Who's the Greyhound? He's a frisky one, isn't he?
Cole Phelps? Mickey Cohen.
I know who he is, Roy. I met his brother-in-law.
Ice cold, man.
I think you had the mixture pretty scared back there.
Operator, message for KGPL.
Putting you through now.
Cole Phelps, badge 1247.
How could I help, Detective?
I need an address for the following phone number. AL345.
The phone number is the Hotel El Mar, 6294 Leland Way, Hollywood.
Thank you.
You know the place? Flop House. Quarter a night, no questions asked.
There's his car.
You drive. I need to go over the case notes.
Cole sure does love going over his case notes.
You seem to have a pretty cozy relationship with Cohen and Stampinato.
Do I note a hint of reprimand in your tone, Detective? Talking to gangsters comes with the turf. You should try out Mickey's place. He's got a haberdasher's up on Sunset. See if he can get you out of those old man's clothes that you slink around in.
It's a front for his illegal activities.
It is that, but he does carry some very sharp suits.
If it's okay with you, I'll stick with Brooks Brothers.
Brooks Brothers, by the way, is a very old men's clothiers company. So, yeah, they would be old man clothes. Ah, yes, back in the day when you could advertise the fact that you have hot water. Not even air conditioning, just hot water.
Yeah, what do you want?
LAPD. We're making inquiries into the whereabouts of an Albert Hammond.
No one here by that name.
You sure?
Sure, I'm sure. This isn't the sort of place where people use their real names. Take a look at the register if you don't believe me.
If he's just here for boxing, why would he use a fake name?
Okay, so look for prominent Tommies. That should narrow it down.
Let's see. Orson Welles spent some time over in Britain, but he is American. Winston Churchill.
Winston Churchill. A very patriotic Englishman is staying in room 207.
The old bulldog. Even at a flop house, Adley can't get out from his shadow.
You know, this particular puzzle can actually be kind of difficult if you don't know what Limey and Tommy refer to.
Three blondes walk into the bar.
The door's unlocked. Looks like he's had a broad up here.
They are kind of old-fashioned nicknames for British people, after all.
Hey, there's such a thing as soap now.
I guess a fighter has plenty of time on his hands between bouts.
Actually, they mostly spend that time training.
Does Albert have somebody special? I didn't see anyone in his corner at the fight.
That are recovering from boxing matches. It's a really rough sport.
He must be heading home. You know, I hope he makes it.
That crooked son of a bitch, no chance.
Looks like he contacted his mother.
Instaheat. Adrian Black's product of choice. Seems like a lifetime ago.
Yeah, first traffic case.
Candy has expensive taste. Albert has his work cut out for him.
Who's Candy?
Candy Edwards, the lady who filled out this coupon.
All right, let's go after his girl, see if that gets us any closer.
Looks like Albert has been doing some homework. 11 grand would be a nice little nest egg.
Damn. But, wait, if the odds were so much stacked against Hammond, why did so many people bet on him to take a dive?
All right, let's go after his girl, see if that gets us any closer.
Like, if Roy here is out 50 bucks, then the money he would have gotten from the other guy winning is $1 on his 50. I mean, I suppose they bet on something else happening.
You know the way. You can drive.
So, you boxed in the Marines?
We all did. Standard training.
I can't imagine you ever played dirty.
The only prize for taking a fall was 1,000 push-ups.
I mean, I suppose they could have bet on, like, when the knockout happens, but still. You'd expect them to fix a more sporting match.
We need to know which room is Candy's.
Can Here's what I heard.
LAPD, ma'am.
Cops.
You're looking for Candy Edwards.
Apartment 7. You take the outside stairs by the parking lot and turn left at the top. You friends of the Italian guy?
Italian guy?
Yeah. Sleazy type. Gave his name as Carlo. I didn't like the look of him, but Candy has some funny friends.
Thanks.
This Candy broad must be as sweet as she sounds. All these gentlemen callers.
Sounds like the manager got here before we did.
Give it up,
sounds
bitch.
Like we're missing all he's the fun. Get in there, Phelps.
You know where he's hiding.
Now you got it, done it.
Like hitting women, do you?
We had a goddamn.
This isn't gonna end well for you.
I don't get when I can and can't do the finisher, the ground finisher thing. Oh, I kept my hat on. For once. And it's in the mission about boxing. Go figure.
Out cold, but breathing. Give her a minute and take a look around.
Single ticket, one way. I guess there isn't a lot for Albert in Ohio.
It would get him halfway across the country, though.
Escania sails from New York.
The side that, you know, has boats that go to England. I don't think that's anything. We can check the unconscious man's body. And yeah, his hand doesn't have anything on it. Need to check his pockets.
Nasty weapon.
All the Italians carry them. A real man uses his fists or a gun.
Carlo here seems to have the same friends as Hammond. What are the odds on them all being bookmakers?
The check marks are the ones that were on Hammond's list, by the way. The X's weren't.
Take a seat, Miss Edwards. We have some questions for you to answer.
Look, I haven't done anything wrong.
Ever? I find that pretty hard to believe.
Can you answer some questions now, Miss Edwards?
Sure, I've had worse. I'll shake it off.
From who?
We're trying to track down Albert Hammond. We have reason to believe he might be in danger. Do you know where he is?
No, I don't. I'm over Albert. I haven't seen him.
Uh-huh.
You're lying, Candy. You were in his hotel room. He came back after the fight and you weren't there. What happened?
You can't prove that I was in the room.
Actually, I can. Very easily.
How do you think we found you, Candy? You wrote your name and address on a coupon.
Look, Albert was supposed to take a fall. We were all supposed to make a little money out of it. But Albert got too goddamn stubborn. Said his pride was all he had left. So I told him, shove it. Let's see his pride keep him warm at night.
So you walked out before the fight?
Yes, I did. What's the problem? I didn't take anything.
Do the names Harry, Mervyn, or Ray mean anything to you?
Could be anybody. How the hell would I know?
Since you were in the hotel room.
They're bookmakers, aren't they? Tell me the truth.
How the hell would I know?
She probably saw the list.
Albert wrote his winnings down on a notepad in the hotel room. We found the odds in his locker. Who has the betting slips?
That son of a bitch, Albert. Everyone thought he was dumb, including me. But he beat them all.
You're leaving town, Miss Edwards?
Yes, I'm going straight home.
You're lying to me. Albert finally won a big fight. I say good luck to him. But you know where he is. Let me help him, Candy.
Do all you cops run off at the mouth? Prove I know where he is.
Well, that part, unfortunately...
Don't ask, you never find out. Albert is going home by boat as soon as he collects his winnings. I know you're going to meet him.
Albert is going to collect nothing. He'll be lucky if he can get out of town in one piece.
How will you fare any better? They already believe you're in on it.
Hell, I know you're in on it.
You can think what you want, Buster. I'll take my chances. I got a few errands to run, and then I say adios to this dump.
Do you want to press charges against Arcaro?
Just get him out of here. That's all I want.
Get out, Carlo, you hump. And get rid of that pig sticker. You ever pull that thing on me, I'll shoot you like a dog.
That bitch knows where Hammond is. She knows where my money's gone.
My money too, tough guy. I'll handle this.
Good luck, Miss Edwards.
I hope things work out for you.
Thank you. It's very kind of you to say so.
Bad people are looking to hurt Candy, and yet she's not heading straight for the train station? I smell a payoff. I say stake her out. See where she goes. Tail this broad. Don't let her get away, but don't get spotted. I'll bring up the car behind you.
Hey, put the roof up for once. Also, this is the most conspicuous, inconspicuous spot Cole could have chosen. I mean, there is nobody else around. He's wearing the same outfit he was yesterday. Alright, by the way, I should mention that for this mission, there's this particular achievement you can get for getting through this entire section here without either taking cover behind a wall, like so, like as in using the whole taking cover left control button, or by using one of the incognito locations. Aside from the one that you start with automatically. So, as such, I'm going to pretend like I'm trying to get that particular achievement. And as such, I'm going to continue to stand behind cover objects that break line of sight, because unlike tailing in a car, tailing on foot is actually relatively realistic in this game. You start to lose when the camera, not Cole, but the camera loses line of sight on the tailing subject. And she sees you.
Too much slack.
If she has an unbroken line of sight to Cole when she's turned around, when she's looking behind her. So it's actually relatively realistic. And you can give her quite a bit of slack before Cole starts complaining, and you can give her quite a bit more before you actually lose the mission. And meanwhile, in getting this achievement, Cole looks like a complete doofus by walking up to brick walls and just staring at them. And by the way, incognito spots include newspapers on chairs, displays like this one, and shoe shining stands like we passed earlier.
Too much slack. Gotta get closer.
So yeah, that's why there's a bunch of window displays, unlike entire portions of the rest of Los Angeles. And why there's a shoeshine stand there and nowhere else in the entire city. Ah, damn it. She turned around. So I showed you that so I can show you this. There are checkpoints during this particular following thing. And also, you can see on the right there is a drain pipe I can climb up. And so, yeah, you can actually tail her from the rooftops if you so choose. It's got its own sort of issues to go along with it. And yeah, I'm not going to make you sit through all of the tailing that the checkpoint didn't let me skip over. Yeah, you can hide behind the sides of buildings, behind trees, behind posts, and behind cars. Basically anything you can take cover behind during a firefight, it counts. Of course, hiding behind a car doesn't work quite so well when you're not allowed to duck, because you're not using the take cover action. But so long as you can keep Cole out of sight from her, and the camera in sight of her...
Much slack. Gotta get closer.
And it doesn't matter how many times Cole complains. It'll work.
Move in. Can't risk losing the trail.
And I believe she'll look behind her more often if you get too close. I guess the idea is that you're making noise. She can hear someone following her. So it is good to give her some distance. Unfortunately, trailing her is actually fairly easy in this mission, because there's a lot of cover, a lot of right angles, a lot of places for Cole to hide when she glances behind her like that. Now, this is a particularly long alleyway, but I can watch her reach the end like so.
Too much slack. I get closer.
And we're done. Interesting that they covered all the windows with newspaper.
Bookmakers?
Yes.
Surprise, surprise.
Did they really need to get into the car for that?
That's a guy from the paper. Saw that in the paper.
A blonde woman just came in here. She went out the back way. Said she was being watched.
How much did she collect?
$3,600. She cleaned me out.
On the Hammond-Kid Galahad fight?
You got it. I'm not complaining. We all made a lot of money on that one. Huge plunge on Galahad, and then Hammond knocks the bum out.
So she collected the money and went out through the back door?
Nope. She made a phone call over there, wrote something on a notepad, and then left.
I guess we're going to do the whole notepad trick again.
What are you doing? Old intelligence trick from the Marines.
And by the way, I looked this up, and apparently in the state of California, it is legal to make a bet, but it is illegal to take a bet. So everybody coming in here is doing legal things.
We know where she's headed. Let's get moving.
But the bookmakers themselves are illegal. As the sort of gray area, which is why even Cole doesn't actually care. But it is why they all have to be, all the bookmakers are fronts.
You can drive.
Hammond backed himself to win.
And Candy is picking up the winnings. Smart play.
Question is Candy collecting on Albert's behalf, or is she cheating him too?
Car 11K, 11 King, further to your request, Bumco Fraud has three known bookmakers operating out of storefronts in the Hollywood area. Thrifty Liquor, 6106 Santa Monica, the Examiner Drugstore, and a Max Spirits at 1658 North Cherokee.
I guess if we didn't get the address, we could use that. Because We already just saw one of the bookmakers. Then there's the drugstore here. And we already knew there were 3 points on Hammond's list. That one guy looks kind of familiar. Who just walked out? I swear I've seen him before.
Detectives Phelps and Earl, LAPD.
Relax, Cole. You just have a blonde in here, Mervin?
Sure did. I'm just about to close up. She took me to the cleaners. 4,000 clams and change.
How long ago did she leave?
Maybe 5 minutes. Called a cab. Asked for a number. I told her there was a card over there by the phone.
That man needs to stop smoking.
Yellow cab. We need to get after her. Fast.
Operator, give me R&I.
Putting you through now.
Can you connect me to the Yellow Cab Company? Hollywood 2187, please. This is Detective Phelps, LAPD. You dispatched a cab to 1487 Ivar Avenue, Hollywood.
Yes, sir. Send one round from the pool.
Do you have the number of that cab?
Number 179.
Thanks.
We're done playing around. Get Mervin to give us an address on Ray's place.
You have any idea who Ray is?
Sugar Ray.
Not now, Mervin. Cole doesn't have much of a sense of humor at the best of times.
Ray runs a shop up on North Cherokee Avenue, just south of Hollywood Boulevard.
Nice talking with you. We should have gotten the address from KGPL earlier.
Hammond is over the hill. He's a punching bag for the up-and-comers. She knows his goddamn place.
I think he knows. I think he worked out the place isn't L.A.
He's punchy. His brain's going to mush. Winston Churchill? Give me a break. Churchill?
Whoops.
Christ!
Churchill is a fighter, boy. Hammond didn't just scribble down the first name he could think of.
Frost planning on cleaning out every bookmaker in town.
Hammond needed to make sure he was getting the paper paid him and he'd be taking the flop.
Never trust the limeys, especially where a fight's concerned. A mistake we can't seem to stop making. Take the next right turn.
I think that's an insult based on World War II. Not like the one pedestrian just sort of stopped and stared at me. Seems appropriate.
That's the cab waiting up ahead. She's not in the car. Don't get too close.
She must be inside.
Hey, now Cole's stopping next to fire hydrants. He's also hanging out with Roy after hours, too.
We're on the move again, Cole. After her. Don't lose that cab.
Did you notice that? Like, this is the only mission which starts because Cole is hanging out with his partner after hours. Meanwhile,
how many stops is she gonna make?
Rusty is going bowling and not even telling Cole that the other officers have a game every week.
Hammond is full of himself, being this sure he was gonna win.
Yeah, no kidding. The odds were stacked 20 to 1. He spent a lot of money. Even if he was going to get this much of a return, just on the off chance that he would actually win. He could have invested that in a less risky bet. Or hell, maybe his opponent actually took a dive. Maybe Maybe that's the secret of this case. Also, does she know that she's being followed in the cab? Because he's taking a very circuitous route.
That bitch has given me what I'm owed. That's all I know.
Really, Roy? Really? You're owed $51.
Can you quit driving like a jackass already?
Hey, that was the other guy's fault this time. By the way, did you notice that all of the other yellow cabs in existence have disappeared for this particular stretch?
Pull over. She's heading inside. I think I just saw Hammond. I'll tail him. You get in there and stay with Candy. Make sure you don't let her see you.
Well, fair enough.
As the cannibals finished off eating the clown, one said...
Luckily, there's a newspaper right here.
How bad is it? Come on, you can tell me.
I can press a button to focus on her.
All-American number 229 has been canceled.
So yeah, I'm not moving the camera. I'm just holding down a button.
When is America gonna understand... It's not about getting, it's about giving. This guy's got a screw loose.
Well, shit.
What the hell?
But you didn't need to kick the door in, Cole. It's a public restroom, it was unlocked.
Roy! Call an ambulance.
Hammond got away.
Try and sit still, Candy.
Mickey.
Who shot you? Was it Albert?
Carr.
They're on the way. I have a patrolman searching the depot. The chief's putting together a manhunt for Hammond. He got the money, right?
Looks like it.
A tough bird, our limey friend. Using his girlfriend as the bag woman and then getting greedy over the split. He won't make it out of town.
That's how you see it?
I told you that cocksucker was a crook.
Did he just assume that she would go into the ladies' room? Is that why he was creeping around the window outside? Or did he see her go in and then assume that she would go into the ladies' room? This was a pretty brazen attack, one way or the other.
.32 caliber, one shot fired. The Egyptian Theater.
Oh hey, it's that movie. The one that this mission is based on.
So, what now?
The theater, I guess. We don't have much else to go on.
The only defense I can figure for why we would go to the theater is that Hammond doesn't live here, so it would be one of the few places he actually knows about. Why he would assume it would be closed at night, as it turns out to be... It's shaky. It's as shaky as a lot of the rest of the justifications in this case.
Can you drive to this one?
Poor girl. She didn't deserve that.
Poor girl. Half the precinct aren't taking a vacation this year because of her. You need to leave town a lot quicker than that if you decide to screw over Mickey C.
Again, why would they all bet on what was going to be a sure thing anyway? Uh-oh, someone got here before us too.
This seems like a long shot.
Aren't they all?
Car 11K, Car 11K, come in.
car 11, King.
Message from the coroner. The cause of death was a knife wound. Repeat, a knife wound. Revolver appears to have belonged to the victim.
Son of a bitch. He stabbed her.
I thought you said real men use their fists, not guns.
That guinea cocksucker. You think he got the money, too?
Come on, Roy. We're bringing this whole tragedy to its conclusion.
Guinea, by the way, is a racial slur for an Italian, not an Englishman. So that was Roy realizing that Carlo killed her, and not Hammond. Yeah, this has to be like early evening. Why is the theater closed?
Carlo, your gripe was with me. She was collecting the money for you. Mickey made it clear it was either me or you, and I intend to keep on living. She stole those betting slips. She was running out on me.
And you were gonna let her?
No, I let her collect. I set her up, just like she set me up. Just like my manager set me up. Everyone wanted me to take a dive. Everyone wanted me to take the short money. It's for the best, kid.
You were washed up, kid! You couldn't climb, and you were too brave to sink. You were going nowhere!
Maybe, but I had heart. I was a Royal Marine, Carlo. If I lost a fight, it wasn't for lack of trying. And it wasn't for lack of courage. I didn't have much. But I had that.
I did it for you, and that's how you repay me!
You did it for yourself. So did little boy. You did it to make a quick buck, and Candy did it to make her dream come true.
Blah, blah, blah. I've got the money. All I need to do is get rid of you. It's gonna be a shame, kid, but that's business.
Why is he aiming an empty revolver?
We've heard enough, Arcaro. Put down your weapon.
Oh, you're making a now big it's mistake, full. Bullet to the face. That sure chased him off. Not sure where Carlo's buddies here came from, but whatever. And now he has a machine gun, I guess. That's still Carlo up there. Just gotta get a good shot on him.
Where are you?
You limey cocksucker.
Alright, got a shotgun. By the way, because I went backstage here, you will not see a scene of Cole picking up Carlo's keys for the car that he left outside. But he's going to have the keys in this scene.
It's time to come out now, Hammond! Put the gun down, Roy.
That son of a bitch owes me a lot of money.
Catch. Escania sails from New York, Hammond. Be on the next train and don't ever come back.
Why?
Because I was a Marine and I once lacked courage. Everyone deserves a second chance. Now beat it. Fuck you! That English prick is getting away with my money, Phelps!
Donnelly and the homicide squad send their best, Phelps. They're more than pleased that you wrapped up the Edwards killing. They're a little mystified about the motive. You have any ideas on that?
Crime of passion, sir. Looks like some sort of love triangle between the manager, the fighter, and his girlfriend.
No sign of the scrapper?
No, sir. Looks like he left town after the fight.
Okay. It's homicide's problem now. Good work, gentlemen.
I think Cole's being quiet about the whole prize-fighting racket in order to make sure that Roy doesn't, you know, say anything about the boxer getting away. Though he was never in police custody. He didn't vanish from it. Don't know what that's about. For today's film, I'm going to do something different. I'm going to cover the movie which today's case was based on. That's right, it's the classic 1949 boxing noir film, The Setup. The story about the story. Movies and boxing have had an unusually close relationship over the years. Even in the years when boxing hasn't been as popular as it was a century ago, Hollywood has just kept on pumping them out. Hell, the first motion pictures to ever be censored in America were about boxing. Back in the day, prize fighting was illegal in most states, but it was also growing in popularity, and so early censors moved to prevent people from showing footage of boxing matches. But yeah, ever since then, every decade has put out a couple standout boxing movies. I think perhaps it has to do with the inherent simplicity of the conflict. Two men, or two women, climb into a ring, they beat the crap out of each other, and then one of them wins. It's even simpler than with team sports. With team sports, you have to worry about an ensemble cast, not just a single person, and you have to follow them through a whole season, not just a single match. Hell, watch any movie about team sports and you'll see the movie makers simplifying the conflict. They focus on one or two protagonists while the rest of the team fades into the background, and they spend most of their running time on one critical game, with most of the season passing by in a montage. With boxing, you don't need to compensate. It's a straight-up duel, winner take all. The setup also happens to be our very first look at an RKO production, so I'd like to spend a moment on the history of that ill-fated studio. So, around half of the big studios of the Golden Age of Hollywood don't exist anymore, at least not as themselves, but most of that happened relatively recently. RKO, on the other hand, was an early and a complete casualty. Partly it's because RKO was also a late entry. It was founded as recently as 1928, a year before the big stock market crash, and it never really managed to land on its feet after that. On the plus side, though, this meant that RKO was always on the lookout for the next big thing, a new idea that could bring in a lot of money. So while the other studios were settling into their respective niches, RKO was producing experimental risks with budgets that United Artists could never match. RKO is responsible for King Kong, Citizen Kane, The Most Dangerous Game, and Top Hat, part of Fred Astaire's filmography with RKO, with music by Irving Berlin. RKO was also one of the main distributors for early Disney productions, starting with Snow White in 1937 and ending with Peter Pan in 1953. By the 1940s, RKO was seriously hitting the skids in terms of profits, and they began to move towards producing more B-movies to save on budgets. Of course, people could tell when a movie is a cheap pile of crap, and so profits just kept going down. On the plus side, this means they also came out with a bunch of now classic films noir and cheesy horror movies throughout the decade. RKO films from this period include the original Mr. and Mrs. Smith, It's a Wonderful Life, The Best Years of Our Lives, and the original Mighty Joe Young. In 1948, Howard Hughes bought RKO, and although it was never in good shape at any point in its history, Hughes's tendency to micromanage everything did not do the company any favors. It also didn't help that the 1950s was when Hughes began to fully succumb to his obsessive-compulsive disorder, and so he was fixating on things that didn't matter to anyone else. In 1955, Hughes sold RKO to General Tire and Rubber, which was dabbling in broadcast networks, and it sold RKO's film library into television syndication. A fact which explains why so many RKO films became classics only in the 1950s and 60s. Still, the parent company wasn't interested in keeping the Hollywood studio afloat, and so, in 1957, the RKO studio lot was sold off to Desilu, a TV production company, and the RKO era was forever over. The story. Like I said last time, The Setup carries the distinction of being the second movie I've covered to take place in real time. As such, the ending occurs exactly 1 hour and 11 minutes after the start. They even let you know to start counting by showing you a clock that says 9:05. The film starts with a metaphor. A younger newspaper boy horns in on an older guy's turf without even the hint of an apology. We then spend some time with the fans showing up for the boxing matches. They don't seem all that impressed by the match between Bill Stoker Thompson and Tiger Nelson, and one guy even lights his match on Stoker's name. That man, it turns out, is his manager. The manager, Tiny, and the trainer, Red, head across the street to a bar where Tiny takes a $50 bribe from Danny, whose boss Little Boy wants Stoker to take a dive in the third round. This makes sense in the movie, by the way, because Little Boy is building up Tiger Nelson for the big leagues and not actually betting on the outcome. Tiny tells Danny it'll happen and takes the money, but when he leaves the bar, Red says they're taking a risk by not letting Stoker himself in on the deal. But Tiny refuses to tell him. Stoker has been losing fights for years, and telling him now will just mean losing a cut of the money for no reason. We next cut over to the hotel room, where Stoker and his wife Julie are staying. Stoker wakes up just half an hour before his match, and he then argues with Julie about his boxing career. It's about as cliche as it gets. He's convinced he can win, that he's one punch away from victory and retiring in style. But she's worried about all the concussions and physical damage he's taken in the 20 years he's been boxing. Ultimately, he leaves her a ticket for the match, but she refuses to go watch him get clobbered again. Stoker heads into the boxing arena and takes a moment to watch the crowd screaming for blood. Tiny and Red spot him as he's heading to the locker room, and while Red tells him to take it easy, Tiny tells him to go for it. Once Stoker reaches the locker room, we meet some of the other fighters. One of them is an old boxer, even older than Stoker. One of them is a kid who's here for his first professional match. And one of them is a black guy who's just starting to hit his prime. As the trainers are getting the kid ready, the boxer who was in the ring earlier comes in and talks about hitting the other guy in the gut until he fell over. This causes the kid to run into the bathroom and throw up. When he comes out, the older boxers reassure him that this sort of thing happens to everyone, and Stoker starts reminiscing. Gunboat, the older boxer, is up next, and he starts talking about Frankie Manila, a boxer who apparently lost 21 times before becoming the middleweight champion of the world. Meanwhile, Julie almost reconsiders going to watch the fight. But when she hears the screaming fans, she decides to go for a walk instead. The kid comes back in, victorious, and Gunboat heads out for his match. We cut back to Julie, who's getting hassled by some sleazy character, but she brushes him off when she hears the boxing match on the radio, and the announcer says that somebody got knocked out and isn't getting back up. But of course, it's Gunboat, not Stoker, and she breathes a sigh of relief. Back in the locker room, two men have to carry Gunboat in, and the doctor on staff asks him what his name is. When Gunboat says Frankie Manila, the doctor tells them to get a cab and send him to the hospital. By the way, because this movie takes place in real time, it's remarkably laid back, with a lot of quiet moments of Julie exploring Paradise City, and the boxers talking about nothing in particular in the locker room. It gives the film the cadence of Rocky I, more so than its sequels, and it's really what makes the film unusual and worth watching. Eventually, it's time for the main event, which happens to be the black boxer, Luther Hawkins. Stoker is particularly fond of Luke, since they both have the same attitude and the same dreams of greatness. Except, of course, that Luke actually has a shot at becoming champion. After another scene of Julie wandering the streets, Tiny and Red show back up, because it's time for Stoker to go on. He sees Luke on his way in. Luke demolished his opponent, and he wishes Stoker good luck. As Stoker takes his place in the ring, he notices Julie's empty seat, and the cameras start paying attention to the audience again. In particular, we meet Little Boy, a gang boss who apparently went to the same school of acting as Hugo Weaving. As the fight starts, the crowd is obviously on Tiger Nelson's side, and unlike Stoker, Tiger is actually in on the setup. The first round begins, and it mostly consists of Tiger laying blows on Stoker's head, although Stoker does land a few good shots of his own. In the second round, Stoker starts protecting his head, but he still gets a cut on his eyebrow. Despite that, however, Stoker eventually starts landing some serious blows, and that gets everyone else to start worrying. The third round begins, and Tiger starts getting serious himself. Stoker hits the pad, and Tiny starts heading for the exit. But then, Stoker gets back up at the 9 count. When the round ends, Tiger is pissed off, and Tiny finally has to explain about the fix. He promises Stoker an extra $30 to lay down, but when the fourth round begins, Stoker continues with the hard punches. In the meantime, the crowd has switched sides and is now rooting for Stoker. The cut above Stoker's eye has gotten worse, but he keeps fighting. Stoker falls down again, and he hears everyone telling him to give up, to quit, to lay down. However, he climbs to his feet just in time to stay in the match, and since Nelson isn't used to his opponents refusing to give up, he really starts falling apart under Stoker's blows. Tiny and Red get the hell out of there once it's clear Nelson is going to lose, and eventually, Stoker gives him one good punch and lays him out on the floor. As Stoker's getting patched up in the locker room, Danny and Little Boy come and visit him. Little Boy explains that he's not upset that Stoker won the match, since after a few more wins, Nelson's reputation will be just fine. He's upset that he paid Stoker for something and he didn't get it. Stoker tries to explain that he didn't see a dime of Little Boy's money, but the mobster only says they'll talk about it later. Stoker gets dressed in a hurry and runs out the back door when he sees men out front waiting for him, but they spot him in the alley and start beating him up. Stoker gets a hand loose and manages to sock Little Boy in the mouth, so Little Boy decides to break his hand with a brick, so he'll never be able to box again. Eventually, Stoker stumbles to his feet, and some partygoers think he's drunk. But once Julie spots him, she knows he's in trouble. He explains about the fix, and that they broke his hand, which means he'll have to retire now, and Julie tells him it'll be all right. They'll do one of the things he promised earlier, like open a cigar stand, or start training one of the younger boxers. The last thing Stoker says is that he won tonight. And, thinking it over, Julie responds with, "We both won tonight." Thus, as the camera pans back and we see that exactly 1 hour and 11 minutes have passed since the movie began, we get the unusual conclusion in which the protagonist gets a career-ending injury, and yet everyone has a happy ending. The analysis. One thing I didn't mention earlier is that this movie is based on an unusual source, a narrative poem, and one written back in 1928. The overall premise is the same, but most of the details are different. For one thing, in the poem version, Stoker is beaten to death on the railroad tracks instead of getting crippled in an alleyway. Oh, and in the poem, Stoker is black. And the assumption that he'd lose was more about a black man letting a white man walk all over him than it was about an old man letting the new blood kick his ass. There were objections to this change, of course, and RKO's defense was that they didn't have a black lead actor under contract at the time. But under the old studio system, you couldn't just promote a supporting actor at will even if he or she did show promise. And honestly, I'd say I believe them. The character of Luther Hawkins feels like an apology. He's sympathetic, he has a lot in common with the protagonist, he's the best boxer in the locker room, he's the main attraction for the evening, and he handily wins his match. So the problem wasn't that the filmmakers were racist in this case, but at the same time, there is a problem. Whitewashing, the practice of using white actors for non-white roles, has recently raised a stink again, and the studio's defense is the same now as it was in previous decades. First, that they don't have enough non-white lead actors to fill all the roles, and second, racism is still enough of an issue in America and European nations that promoting a non-white actor to the point of becoming a leading man or leading lady often means taking a financial hit since certain people will avoid the film. So who's really at fault here? Everyone. It's a feedback loop. People think that white people are the best, so they go watch films that confirm their bias. Hollywood studios want to make money, and so they concentrate on the most profitable trends. Then, people are only exposed to films in which white people are the best, and so the bias develops further. But a feedback loop can change, and the change can come from any part of the loop. Hollywood studios and directors can groom more non-white actors for starring roles. Audiences can prove that there is a market for minority lead actors by going to see the films that do have them, and they are out there. If you think the system is unfair, don't just complain. Do something about it. Because you're a part of the system too. We've already seen a lot of improvement over the past few decades, and we could see a lot more if we got up off our asses and put them in theater seats. Thanks for joining me again for today's film review, and I hope you'll join me next time for a famous film noir, part of the Criterion Collection, which happens to be one extended love letter to the people and the police of New York City.